Hello everyone, and let's start with the third and the last session on this chapter, A Visit to Cambridge, written by Firdaus Kanga.
Can you hear me? It has been a glorious time to be alive, and doing research in theoretical physics. Our picture of the universe has changed a great deal in the last 50 years, and I'm happy if I have made a small contribution. The fact that we humans, who are ourselves mere collections of fundamental particles of nature, have been able to come this close to an understanding of the laws governing us and our universe, is a great triumph. I want to share my excitement and enthusiasm about this quest. So remember to look up at the stars and not down at your feet. Try to make sense of what you see, and wonder about what makes the universe exist. Be curious. And however difficult life may seem, there is always something you can do, and succeed at. It matters that you don't just give up. Thank you for listening.
Well, in the last two sessions, I finished with the reading and explanation of this chapter, and today we are going to do its summary, working with text and working with language sections of this chapter. So without wasting much of time, let's start right now. The chapter, A Visit to Cambridge, is written by Firdaus Kanga. The chapter presents the story of a meeting between the author Firdaus Kanga and the great scientist Stephen Hawking. Both were extraordinary people, as they were differently abled. The great men exchanged thoughts on what it means to live life in a wheelchair and on how the so-called normal people react to the disabled. At the end, the author leaves Stephen Hawking with a heavy heart, but thoroughly inspired by his way of living against all odds. Let's now start with working with the text. These are the questions that we need to answer. And in my next slide, I will show you the answers of each question. Let's start with the first question. Did the prospect of meeting Stephen Hawking make the writer nervous? If so, why? Yes, the prospect of meeting Stephen Hawking made the writer nervous because he was going to meet an inspiring personality, and that too one who had achieved greatness despite his disabilities. Part 2. Did he at the same time feel very excited? If so, why? Yes, he felt excited at the same time because it made him feel stronger to see somebody differently abled like him achieving great success and yet was humble and down to earth. Question number 2. Guess the first question put to the scientist by the writer. The writer might have asked the scientist if he had been brave to reach where he had. Question number 3. Stephen Hawking said, "I have had no choice." Does the writer think there was a choice? What was it? The writer thought that there was a choice. Stephen Hawking could have chosen to leave everything and be sad and depressed. However, he chose to live creatively despite his bodily constraints. Question number 4. I could feel his anguish. What could be the anguish? Stephen Hawking's mind was active with many thoughts that he wanted to express. However, his thoughts came out in phrases or small lines, without feelings or emotions. Stephen Hawking's anguish was his inability to express effectively. Question number 5. What endeared the scientist to the writer so that he was looking at one of the most beautiful men in the world? When the writer asked Stephen Hawking if he found it annoying to be disturbed in his work, the scientist replied honestly with his one-way smile. This endeared him to the writer. The writer felt that he was looking at one of the most beautiful men in the world. Question number 6. Read aloud the description of the beautiful man. Which is the most beautiful sentence in the description? The most beautiful sentence in the description is, "You look at his eyes which can speak still and they are saying something huge and urgent." Question number 7, part 1. If the lantern is the man, what would its walls be? If the lantern is the man, its walls would be the man's body. Part 2. What is housed within the thin walls? The inner glow of the man is housed within the thin walls. Part 3. What general conclusion does the writer draw from this comparison? The conclusion that the writer drew from this comparison was that the body exists only like a case made of shadows. It is just an accessory. It is the soul that matters. Each individual is what he is from his heart and soul and not from the body. Question number 8. What is the scientist's message for the disabled? The message that he gave to the disabled was that they should concentrate on what they are good at. Question number 9. Why does the writer refer to the guitar incident? Which idea does it support? He remembered the incident when he unstringed a guitar because he didn't want to play it. It supports Stephen Hawking's idea that the disabled Olympics are a waste of time. One should only concentrate on what they are good at and not take up things unnecessarily. Question number 10. The writer expresses his great gratitude to Stephen Hawking. What is the gratitude for? The writer expressed his gratitude to Stephen Hawking because he had been an inspiration for him. He felt that if he had been as brave as Stephen, he would have achieved a lot. Stephen Hawking had made him realize that one requires will to pursue what one wants. Bodily constraints are just a mental block. Have a look at question number 11. There are two boxes given A and B and a few sentences. We have to complete these sentences taking their appropriate parts from both the boxes. So let's start. The first one, there was his assistant on the line and I told him I had come in a wheelchair from India. Second, you get fed up with people asking you to be brave, as if you have a courage account on which you are too lazy to draw a check. There he was, tapping a little switch in his hand, trying to find the words on his computer. You look at his eyes, which can speak, and they are saying something huge and urgent. It is hard to tell what. And the last sentence, it doesn't do much good to know that there are people smiling with admiration to see you breathing still. Let's come to the first question under working with language. Here you have to fill in the blanks in the sentences below using the appropriate forms of the words given in the box. We have to change these words and then fill in the blanks. Let's start. I met a traveler from an antique land. I need special guidance in mathematics. I can't count the number of times I have failed in the subject. The guide called Stephen Hawking a worthy successor to Isaac Newton. His other problems paled into insignificance beside this unforeseen mishap. The meeting was chaired by the youngest member of the board. Some people say yours truly when they informally refer to themselves. I wish it had been a drawn match. We would have been spared the noise of celebrations at least. In question number 2, look at the following words, walk and stick. Can you create a meaningful phrase using both these words? It is simple. Add ing to the verb and use it before the noun. Put an article at the beginning. So walk and stick will become a walking stick, where walk is a verb and stick is a noun. Now make 6 such phrases using the words given in the box. Let's start. Read session will become a reading session. Smile face will become a smiling face. Revolve chair will become a revolving chair. Walk tour will become a walking tour. Dance doll will become a dancing doll. And win chance will become a winning chance. Let's start with question number 3, where you have to use all or both in the blanks. Let's start. He has 2 brothers. Both are lawyers. More than 10 persons called. All of them wanted to see you. They all cheered the team. Both her parents are teachers. How much have you got? Give me all of it. Now let's move to the last question under this section. Complete each sentence using the right form of the adjective given in brackets. Now we have to fill in these adjectives in its correct degree of comparison form. Let's start. My friend has one of the fastest cars on the road. This is the most interesting story I have ever read. What are you doing now is easier than what you did yesterday. Ramesh and his wife are both short. He arrived late as usual. Even the chief guest came earlier than he did. Drawing the positivity and inspiration from the life of Sir Stephen Hawking, I end my session with this message. That disability is all in the mind. Even normal person can be disabled if he is not mentally strong. So instead of showing sympathy to the differently abled people, let's include them in our society and treat them at par. As I end my session today, I want to pay highest regards to late Stephen Hawking, the Braveheart Firdaus Kanga, and all the differently abled people who are braver than we normal people are. Thank you very much for giving me your time. In my next session, I'm going to bring up a new topic, a poem, when I set out for Lioness. Till then, take good care of yourself and be present for my next one. Thank you very much and goodbye.